Thank you, Martina, so much for the great introduction. And I'm very happy to present this talk to you today. Osteocytes are my passion in bone research, and I would like to share this passion today with you. So the aims for this webinar. So we're first going to talk a little bit about characteristics of osteocytes, and I'm also going to show you some images, hopefully to make you understand what it means if you're looking at osteocyte function. We're also going to talk briefly about methods and imaging to study osteocytes. And then we're going to dive into the multifunctionality of this cell type. And this will hopefully give us some insight of what could be possible in diabetic bone disease with osteocytes and their role in there. And we will have a look at the known or suggested roles for osteocytes in diabetic bone disease at the very end. So, see if the video plays. It's loading right now, but you can appreciate. From these images on the right of this rhodamine infiltrated bone specimen from mice, you can see here we have the osteoblasts on top of a newly formed bone, the osteoid. All is obviously seen in red with this rhodamine staining, but some of the osteoblasts become embedded into the newly formed bone and then further differentiate along the lineage to become osteocytes. So the osteoid osteocyte is actually seen here within the osteoid. Then these osteocytes further differentiate to become mature osteocytes. They form dendrites, as you can see in the bottom image, and that's one of the characteristics of osteocytes. How this differentiation from osteoblasts to osteocytes really works on a molecular level is still to be discovered. There are some initial data that really point also to a role of the extracellular matrix, but also to a few transcription factors. There are certain markers that we know are specific for osteocytes. And you can see here on the right side an histological image and on the left side a sheen of including osteoblasts, but also osteocyte markers. So when osteoblasts differentiate further along the lineage to become osteocytes, their collagen production is really reduced and they start to express early markers of osteocytes. One of the early ones is E11, also called podoplanin, which is actually responsible for the formation of dendrites of these cells. As you can see in the sheen here, there's usually a topical dendrite formation, and then the osteocyte forms these dendrites in a three-dimensional space. The more mature osteocyte express markers such as GMP1, FEX, and MEPI, which are all important for matrix mineralization, and we're going to mention and talk about that later. The late osteocyte, so deeply embedded in the bone matrix, is positive for sclerostin and FGF23, and we're also going to talk about the functional roles of these. The most astonishing characteristic of an osteocyte is really the network. So you are not just looking here at an individual cell, but you have to consider that this is a functional network. So with these three images, I would like to point towards, first of all, the dendritic connectivity on the left side, which you can see by this actin labeling. So the dendrites that are really dense and connecting these murine osteocytes inside the long bone. In the middle image, you can actually appreciate a fluorescent dye, Prussian red, that was injected into a mouse model in the tail vein, and there within minutes has reached the osteocyte network of the long bone. So the fluid-filled volume that surrounds the osteocyte in their peri-lacuna and pericanalicular space. So the lacuna being the place where the osteocyte cell body is sitting inside, and the canalicula is the space where the dendrites are sitting inside. And from the right side, you can see the outside of this lacuna canalicula system in this electron microscope image. This is an acid etch technique here, and you can see the osteocytes being deeply connected with one another and also with the blood vessels within this piece of bone. The other astonishing effects known about osteocytes in the human body. If we estimate the number of osteocytes, we have about 40 billion osteocytes in there. So it's really a major cell type in the bone tissue. We are assuming about 89 dendrites per osteocyte in the human situation. And then you can see these estimations for the combined dendrite length, but also the lacuna canalicula surface. So really a great active surface that the osteocytes are governing inside the bone. One other important aspect to talk about with osteocytes is their variability. So for osteocytes, as we are considering them a post-mitotic cell, their viability becomes really important. And this early work here from Notatate et al. Really demonstrates what can happen with osteoporosis, but also osteoarthritis, where the osteocyte network is disturbed and osteocytes start to die off. There are several hormones such as estrogen withdrawal, but also cytokines that can really stress the osteocyte. Also micro damage can cause the loss of viable osteocyte. And viability is something that is really important for the cell type. And we have looked previously into human bone specimens, where the individuals were either naive or osteoporotic and being treated with denosumab. Denosumab being a RANK ligand inhibitor and really reducing bone resorption, but also bone formation. And within this, these individuals, we found that the number of empty osteocyte lacuna was really prominent. And when we quantified this in the trabecular, but also in the cortical bone compartment, as you can see here by these graphs, we found that there was a significantly higher amount of empty osteocyte lacuna, so where the cells were actually being absent and not viable anymore. And we also had the third group where there was a discontinuation from denosumab without further osteoporosis treatment. And we found that the empty lacuna were persistent, at least in the trabecular bone. Interestingly, also with human bone, we determined the mineralization of the lacuna, this process called micropetrosis. And we saw that with the denosumab treatment in the cortex, there was a large amount, a significant amount being present in these bone specimens. However, if we looked at osteocyte apoptosis, we did not find any significant differences. So that really suggested to us that the low bone turnover situation due to the denosumab treatment is affecting here this parameter, and that's why we see the large numbers of empty and mineralized osteocyte lacuna. So let's talk a little bit about how we can image or how osteocytes are being imaged and studied in vitro and in vivo. You probably have heard a lot about the osteocyte cell lines that are being used. Really established is the MLOY4 cell line, a murine cell line that was established from Bonwald and co-workers. It's really an early osteocyte, so there's not a lot of expression of sclerostin that you find in these cells. The IDG cell line is a different murine cell line that really differentiates in cell culture towards a more mature osteocyte cell type, also expressing FGF23 and sclerostin. Obviously, it's nice to work with primary cells, but for the osteocyte, this is really tricky because of their post-mitotic state. But there are some suggestions and literature out here which you can find here of how you can achieve maybe on a short-term culture to really cultivate a phenotypically good osteocyte. As for oscocytes in the in vivo situation, they are really requiring a loading situation, and we're going to talk about this in a few minutes. There are certain models, such as this fluid flow chamber, that are established to give the osteocyte the stimulus that they are actually requiring for their phenotype. And as of the nature of their three-dimensional arrangement of dendrites and also their network connectivity that you have seen in the previous image, it is quite optimal if you can maybe for your work start thinking of explant culture, or maybe you can collaborate to look into bone biopsy and bioreactors where you can apply a loading regime on your ex vivo bone explants. And there's a great review that I put here on the bottom of the slide that I'd really suggest to you if you want to start looking into ex vivo bone. As for mouse models and transgenic mice, the most established osteocyte-specific knockout mice are really the DMP1 Cre. There's 10 and an 8 kb Cre being established. However, there is a problem with tissue specificity for these mice, so there's also an inducible one available, and people have attempted also to establish the SOST Cre and the SOST ERT2 Cre. However, here there is really a concern so far about the specificity of the knockout that one can achieve. And again, another suggestion from my side, maybe you already had a chance to look into the Herbert Fleisch workshop that was given by Florent Eleftherieux. He really outlines the mouse models that are currently available for bone research, also including the osteocyte specific ones, and talks about the pros and cons. So that's really great to have a look at this one. I would like to summarize the challenges if you want to work with osteocytes or perform osteocyte functional analysis. So as osteocytes are surrounded by the mineralized matrix, the tissue handling and the processing obviously is not trivial. You need specific knives, you may cause some cracks and micro damage also on the site when cutting tissue, so you may want to pay close attention to this. Autofluorescence of the bone matrix is a great topic, and if you're working with confocal microscopy, you definitely have to pay attention and use specific protocols to reduce the autofluorescence. And immunohistochemistry on bone tissue is challenging. So, the osteocyte network also is heterogeneous. Heterogenetic, sorry for my wording. So it's maybe important to look at cortical bone, but also at trabecular bone. You may wanna look also at different sites of the periost, at the endocortical region, and see how your osteocyte network is there. You are requiring, or you may require, high resolution imaging, and you may wanna start looking into 3D visualization methods. And as mentioned already, cell isolation and culture is not trivial with osteocytes. Okay, so now let's dive into the multifunctionality of osteocytes. And the first function that was really attributed to osteocytes was the one of being the mechanosensors of bone. While osteocytes are clearly not the only cell type in bone that is mechanosensitive, you will see from the data that is available that they have a great sensitivity to mechanical stimuli. So there are theories out there and assumptions that we use right now, and we know that if we are placing an anabolic load on the bone, that there's a certain fluid flow that is induced inside the lacuna canalicular system that surrounds the osteocyte, and that this is stimulating the cells, and that these loads are actually at least one magnitude larger than what actually the tissue is experiencing on a larger scale. So mechanosensation in the osteocyte. There are several targets that are being discovered and discussed. And here a great review by Jing and co-workers that discusses the latest research on those. So as you can appreciate from this scheme, there are focal adhesions playing a role, the cytoskeleton, mechanosensitive ion channels such as the piezo, but also the primary psyllium. And I would like to talk a little bit about a few of those and some of the experiments that have been done. So the KIF3A is part of the kinesine complex of the primary psyllium. And this is, and if this is conditionally knocked out, here actually using a COL1-3 mouse, so already in the early in the osteoblast lineage, but also then later once these cells differentiate into osteocytes, there is a reduced anabolic loading response. You can see this here by the bone formation rate that is being depicted in this table, which is reduced in the mice where this complex has been conditionally knocked out, as in comparison to the control, which is here on the bottom. We also know that at least in the load-bearing bones, that not just the lacuna, but also the osteocytes align along the load axis. So you can see this here by these images really showing the osteocyte cell body. And here the arrow indicates the load axis in the fibula, so a load-bearing bone compared to the calvarium, so non-loaded bone. And we these investigators have also seen that the cytoskeleton is specifically arranged in these cells, and you can see that there's the staining here for the paxillin cell adhesion complex, which is more focal and more focused in the load-bearing osteocytes in comparison to the calvarium. So osteocytes are clearly sensitive to fluid flow, and this early work by Klein Newland and al. Really demonstrated these by looking at the time the first established second messengers being released by osteocytes. So one of them has shown to have anabolic effects on bone, and this is released in greater amounts in osteocyte if they were subjected to fluid flow shear stress, as in comparison to osteoblasts but also fibroblasts. And this induction of prostaglandin release is really done in a time-dependent manner. So you can see the comparison of 6 versus 24 hours in osteocytes. And looking at primary cells, so here they utilize primary osteocytes from chicken, but also compared to fibroblasts, also nitric oxide, another anabolic second messenger, is upregulated and, well, actually not upregulated, but early secreted from osteocytes upon fluid flow shear stress, so within minutes even. And this is not seen in the fibroblast cultures. When osteocytes are being exposed to fluid flow and experience a loading regime in a cell culture, there is activation of beta-catenin, so a nuclear translocation, and you've probably all heard of beta-catenin being involved in the canonical wind signaling pathway, so an anabolic pathway in bone. And beta-catenin and its activation is actually both locally and timely regulated upon loading. And this work by Lara Castillo and nicely showed this in the ulnar forearm loading model, where we can see with these blue dots the beta-catenin in osteocytes and these top guy mice being expressed. And you can see with the time course of 1 to until 24 hours that there is a differential expression of osteocytes being positive for beta-catenin, but then also with time, a timely dependence. And if one allele of beta-catenin is abolished in osteocytes utilizing a DMP1 pre. The anabolic loading response is really reduced, actually abolished. So you can see this here both at the endocortical and also periosteal side. But also the cortical thickness that what looked at here. So if you normally have a great anabolic loading regime, both in male and also in female mice, so independent of sex, this is really abolished in these head conditional knockout mice. So osteocytes that are experiencing mechanical loading secrete second messengers, we have already said. And one of the functions of these second messengers is then to regulate bone remodeling. So osteocytes have been now established to regulate bone remodeling activities of both osteoclasts and osteoblasts. As osteocytes are really highly interconnected cells, and also with their lacuna canalicular system being connected to the blood system, so the idea is that these secreted molecules could actually reach the bone surface and there these anabolic and/or catabolic loading signals can be translated into bone remodeling activities in a timely and also locally dependent manner. So we know from studies of unloading or well, not loaded bones that sclerostin, one of the inhibitors of the Wnt signaling pathway, is being expressed by unloaded osteocytes. And as you know from the Wnt signaling pathway, sclerostin acts upon osteoblasts to inhibit their bone formation. You can see here by the work from Roebling and co-workers that if they compared, first of all, a non-loaded versus a loaded bone, that the non-loaded bone had a higher expression of sclerostin mRNA, but also on protein level. And another study here also looked at DKK1 expression and confirmed that there's a greater expression of sclerostin in these non-loaded bones. And actually also in a time-dependent manner, this was, if this was investigated. And a study which looked at hind limb unloading, so where the mice were pulled up by their tail to basically create an unloading situation. And they were given sclerostin antibody. As you would see here, the normal loss of bone mineral density upon hind limb unloading, both in the total body, but also in the hind limb, was actually quite lower if sclerostin was inhibited. Osteocytes also express high levels of RANK ligand, and early work by Bonewald and co-workers showed that osteoclasts express greater amounts of RANK ligand compared to osteoblasts. And by this means, osteoclasts can regulate the bone resorption activity of osteoclasts. And in 2011, there was a back-to-back publication of two groups really deciphering this mechanistically in mouse models, utilizing the DMP1 pre for osteocyte specific knockout. You can appreciate here on the left from these micro CT images that if RANK ligand was knocked out using the DMP1 pre, there's an osteopetrotic phenotype. So there's a lot of bone mass seen in these femora. This was also quantified here, looking at the bone volume, but also the trabecular thickness was much greater if RANK ligand was knocked out. On a cell mechanistic level, you can see that there's a reduction in osteoclast number, but also eroded surface. The other group then also reported tail suspension, so again, hind limb unloading, as just mentioned in the previous slide. So while we had normally with tail suspension, we have this loss in bone mineral density, as we just talked about. In the DMP1 CRE, this loss compared to baseline is less pronounced and actually not significant. There are also other parameters that were looked at here, also osteoclast numbers, but also the cortical thickness, which was reduced in the wild type control, so the phlox mice, but was not significantly reduced in the DMP1 CRE. Now I would like to talk about, I guess, one of my most favorite topics with regards to osteocytes, so the perilacunar remodeling that these cells actually can perform, so the active bone remodeling by osteocytes. And this theory is quite old and reaches back to actually the beginning of the last century, and there were a lot of studies in the 1960s and 70s on hibernating animals, but also PTH that was inducing a larger lacuna, and where people were saying, so the osteocytes are really resolving their perilacunar matrix. So the idea is that because osteocyte governs such a great surface in bone, that is just predestines them to actually do something with that surface and really be active about it. But there was in the middle or end of the 1970s quite a stop in this research. People were suggesting this could be a methodological artifact. I mean, we are also talking, you know, in small dimension of this bone resorption that is taking place here. But luckily, more mechanistic data and a lot of studies now in the previous years have really shown that osteocytic osteolysis contributes to calcium removal from the bone matrix. So the first study that really focused on perilacunar remodeling on a mechanistic level was to look at mice that were lactating, so basically producing milk, which requires a lot of calcium from the bone matrix. And there we found that the osteocyte lacuna were really larger in comparison to the virgin mice, and that once post-lactation, that actually osteocyte lacuna size could be normalized, as you can see here in these top images of backscattered electron microscopy. This effect was depending upon the PTH1 receptor and actually upon PTHRP, which acted via this receptor, and PTHRP injection also simulated an osteocytic osteolysis phenotype. And the table that you see here depicted basically is shown here to emphasize that these osteocytes upon lactation really express a large amount of genes that would normally be attributed to osteoclasts. So you can see here TREP, cathepsin K, but also genes that are associated with proton release and proton production, so carbonic anhydrase, the ATPase vacuolar subunits, but also NMP13. And as I cannot go through all these studies that are currently out there and all the molecular mechanism that is already out there, I would like you to please have a look at this review mentioned here. What we have seen previously is that osteocytes really acidify their microenvironment upon lactation, and we utilized a pH specific dye or sensitive dye to show this. You can see here in these virgin mice that the dye was infiltrating the lacuna of the osteocytes, and the pH shift in this dye is seen in the red color. And if we quantified these upon lactation, we could say that the osteocyte lacuna space was really more acidic. So one question that obviously then came into our mind was, so if the osteocytes are bathed in this acidic environment, how can they possibly survive this? So talking about viability of these cells, And what we could see in vitro using several different cell lines, but also primary cells, is that when we drop the pH in cell culture for a few hours or even up to 24 hours, that the osteocyte viability was always more superior, as depicted here in these green lines, as compared to an osteoblast or a fibroblast cell line or primary cell. If we consider or talk about perilacunar remodeling, we also have to talk a little bit about the bone formation by osteoblasts. So mechanistically, there's maybe not so much known, but definitely osteocytes contribute to bone matrix mineralization. Osteocytes express large amounts of DMP1, as you can see here in these immunohistochemical images. And if DMP1 is knocked out, there is quite a mineralization defect seen in bone. As you can see here, with the stainings, the red being less mineralized bone, and the green shows you the mineralized bone matrix. And this is also particularly pronounced around the osteocyte and the osteocyte lacuna. DMP1 knockout really leads to enlarged lacuna, but also to elevated levels of FGF23 expression by osteocytes. And FGF23 will be important when we talk about osteocytes. And one last function of them that I would like to mention, the regulation of distant tissue functions. That the osteocyte secretes molecules with endocrine functions was suggested by early work, and I think now more and more investigators and publications have really shown this. So also we know that there are pleiotropic genes that affect tissues, and here the work looking at skeletal muscle and bone is really pointing out. Osteocytes and FGF23. So osteocytes can express large amounts of FGF23, for instance, here in chronic kidney disease. Chronic kidney disease being obviously a pathology with several aspects that come into mind, and I just mentioned a few of them here. And while it is known nowadays that it's not entirely the FGF23 coming from the osteocytes that plays a role here with, for instance, the cardiovascular complications, but it seems to contribute to a significant extent at least. And FGF23 released from osteocytes, as you can see here, and this sheme is involved in several functions in the body. So this growth factor really points out that the osteocyte has endocrine functions in the body. When we looked into osteocyte and distant tissue functions, we actually focused on the effects of the muscle factors that actually work on osteocytes and really have an effect on the osteocyte itself. And we have looked into conditioned medium from muscle cells and how this could prevent osteocyte apoptosis in our cell culture model. And we also determined that when we took conditioned medium from an ex vivo contracted muscle, as you can see here in this little image here on the top, that we could prevent osteocyte apoptosis, which was previously induced by dexamethasone. And we also saw that this was mediated by beta-catenin in osteocytes, and later studies pointed also towards a myokine that is responsible for this activity. And there are several other studies looking at osteocalcin and others that are really showing an effect of osteocytes on distant tissue functions. And I would just encourage you to really go into the literature and read upon this. Because for the last few minutes of this webinar, I would like to take the challenge and talk a little bit about potential roles of osteocyte in diabetic bone disease. what is known in the literature? So definitely there has been a lot of attention on sclerostin and SOST expression by osteocytes. And this study also by Bodenwald and co-workers from 2019 showed in this IW3 osteocyte cell line that upon long exposure with a high glucose level, these osteocytes here seen at 28, but also 35 days in cultures have a high expression of sclerostin SOST mRNA. And if these investigators isolated osteocytes from control and diabetes mice and exposed them to different glucose concentrations, they also found that there was a large expression of SOST upon in diabetic osteocytes, actually, that was also seen if they were cultured in normal glucose level concentrations. They also looked at sclerostin protein expression, as you can see here. Other investigators have looked also into glucose-dependent effects on osteocytes, and these were the MLOY4 osteocytes. And while you can maybe suggest there's a slight effect on apoptosis here with this tunnel staining with a high glucose level, this actually was not statistically significant. But interestingly, these investigators showed glucose dependency upon mitochondria functions. So they used the MitoTracker to stain the mitochondria in these cell types. And upon high glucose concentrations, so the bottom of these images here, they were finding that the mitochondria were more circularly arranged around the cell nucleus, and that this was more suggestive of a phenotype of the mitochondria that really goes along with cell stress. Other investigators have also looked into the effect of high glucose, but also AGEs on osteocyte apoptosis, but also RANK ligand expression. So here in this work that also from a time point of view, I find really interesting is that only upon longer-term culture within a high glucose medium, there was a significant effect on apoptosis by high glucose concentration, but also upon exposure to a significant amount of AGE levels. The investigators then also looked at the RANK ligand expression of the surviving osteocytes in the whole cell lysate, which was actually reduced with the AGE exposure. But in the supernatant, they found that upon AGE exposure, that there was actually a larger or a higher release of RANK ligand by these osteocytes. There are further studies which I would like to summarize here in this slide. So in Ankita mice, researchers have found a reduced cortical lacuna density, suggesting also a loss of osteocyte numbers, at least in the cortex of this mouse model for diabetes. Other researchers looked into beta-catenin expression in cortical osteocytes utilizing CD1 mice induced with streptocytosine, and they found that this was significantly reduced. High glucose also attenuated the mechanically induced calcium response in MLOY4 osteocytes in this study. Some researchers have reported on reduced periosteal mineral apposition rate in Ankita mice, but only in male mice. This was not found in female mice, interestingly. And we know that PPAR gamma deletion in osteocyte can enhance insulin sensitivity upon age. And our recent work showed an elevated number of micropertosis in the periosteal region, specifically in the ostiums of type 1 diabetic individuals, also suggesting an influence of osteocyte viability with diabetic bone disease. And I would like to finish my talk with the acknowledgement, thanking the whole team of the IOBM at the UKE, my previous co-workers at the Human KC, where I showed a few data points, our collaborators from the Bone Lab in Dresden, with whom we work closely together in our diabetes project, but in general, all the investigators involved in the Fidelio program. And thank you so much for your attention. And I'm welcoming questions now.